Thank you. It feels a bit odd standing behind the desk. Jim, thank you for the introduction. I saw a lot of words that will come back in my presentation as well. Very much focused on outcome. I like to walk you through some of my observations on the overall challenges to the function and the things that we have done within Philips, at least focused on one element of the communications function, which is the external communication function, and where we have made a connection to the with the business objectives of the organization and relate that to a communication matrix. Now I have to click. Very short, 15 years of experience, as the video already demonstrated. I love to, this is not a Dutch basketball team, it's just a local basketball team playing in Orange. My kids are part of that. Worked in Central Eastern Europe, worked in the US, currently working in the Amsterdam headquarters. For a company that is has an ambition to improve people's lives, to improve the lives of 3 billion people in 2025. Why do I demonstrate this slide? Not to do a PR story for my company, but to illustrate the fact that we as Philips are not the company that is focusing only on consumer electronics anymore, but not many people know that 70% of our business is generated via healthcare and lighting. I think a lot of us grew up with Philips TVs, Philips audio, video, Philips equipment at home. That is a minority part of the business. To demonstrate that, or to, as an example, last night at 1 o'clock, we signed a deal in the U.S., a $300 million deal with one of the biggest hospitals in the U.S. to provide care, healthcare in their hospitals, in their children's hospitals for the next 15 years. How does our organization look like? 150 communications professionals around the globe and 25 colleagues at the headquarters in Amsterdam, of which at least one is here in the room as well. Change is happening for our function, and which is good. Change is good. It started already 10 years ago, 15 years ago, when our function was heavily influenced by internet. In the meantime, if you look at our function, we focus on a lot of digital channels, which is not actually changing the delivery of the message. We only have to pick all the different channels to deliver the same message. It's about dialogue and using and choosing the right channel. As the example showed of one of our agencies, if you want to eat and want to sell a donut, these are the channels you use, from Twitter to Google+. I'm eating a donut to Google+. I'm a Google employee who eats donuts. The amount of connected devices, I already said, digital is for us an enormous challenge. If you look at it in 2003, less than one digital device connected to us. In 2020, close to 7 digital devices connected to us as people on the globe. That is a lot. I see it already with my children playing with 2 or 3 digital devices, where I only have my BlackBerry and my laptop. I'm regarded as old-fashioned. And the amount of connected devices in 2020, 50 billion. For us, that's a challenge, because we're still not used to it. We still have to find a way how to connect with people, how to connect with consumers, how to connect with customers, and what the previous speaker said, how to facilitate a dialogue with people, because I think that is one of the most challenging things for us as organizations, because we are still used to a model where we send, where we broadcast, and a lot of us have still have to get into a mode of facilitating a dialogue. At the same time, all of us here in the room are faced with budget cuts. I think that's not a secret. Is that a glass which is half empty? No, for me it's a glass which is half full. Because it requires creativity, and it can put you on the map in your organization if you find the right things to do. And if you find the right things to do to relate your communications activities to the business objectives, to the objectives of your organization if you work in an NGO. First of all, we have to focus on integrating all our activities. I'm representing mainly an external comms function, but I could not exist or I could not have impact for my organization if I would not team up with all the other colleagues, all the other functions in my organization. I think the time for siloed thinking should be over, if not already over. We have to work across the along the lines of the so-called PISO model. Paid media, earned media, shared media, owned media. They go hand in hand, while the engagement, of course, differs per version of media. This is the future. This is how we have to work. And if you work like this, and if you work with this integrated model, you will come to a situation where your impact and where the outcome will be much bigger. Where earned media is progressing and is gaining much more traction than it used before. And just an example of how we do this in the meantime, we recently opened one of the most well-known museums in Amsterdam, where one of the most well-known Dutch paintings is exhibited, the Night Watch, where if you look at our function 10 years ago, the communications of such an exhibition, such a illumination via sustainable LED light of a Night Watch would have been completely different and completely isolated. We're living in a global village. We're living in a village where the .com, the .org and the .gov are highly interconnected. If I can give one recommendation here, there's a beautiful book by an Indian thinker, Parag Khan, who describes in only 300 pages how the future economy will develop according to these three things, where .com, .org and .gov are highly interconnected. For us as a company which is in business to business and who sells products, technologies to the governments of this world, this is unbelievably important. Speed is everything. What happens in India or China in 5 seconds happens in Amsterdam, in my case, or in Brussels. 24/7, internal is external, external is internal, dialogue versus monologue, and everybody is a spokesperson. Are we ready for that? Are we ready for the fact that 118,000 employees of Philips are potential spokespeople? And how do we facilitate them? And how do we measure if they are actually effective? As I said already, the time of monologue is over. The broadcasting from that headquarters in Amsterdam is gone to the past. People don't care what you say about your company. It's the people who are talking. And we have to realize that. It's the people who are talking, and if they're not satisfied, they will let you know in a very visual way. Without any shame, you will be notified of the fact that you cannot deliver service. When I started in Philips, I was in the left part of the communications function. Traditional media, traditional channels, traditional ways of communicating with the outside world. In the meantime, there is a new reality. New reality where everything is emerging. Viral, traditional, new channels that I would not know 2 years ago are now more important than the traditional channels. This changes the way that we make decisions, especially the impact of digital. Did you know that 70% of buyers say they are more likely to buy from a company when a CEO whose CEO uses social media? I didn't know until yesterday. And we have to tell our CEOs, our business partners, how to interact in such a fast-changing world. And how to communicate and how to focus on outcomes instead of only on output and focus on the activities, not only focus on the activities, but the actual impact of the activities. Just an example what we did with my CEO, who started in 2011, who became the successor of a very successful CEO who was there for 11 years, and started to use language internally, but mainly externally, that did not resonate well. And we looked at the output, we looked at the activities, and we did analysis, we did data analysis, we researched all his external verbiage, and where we came to the fact that the green words are the words that resonate well in the minds of the people, of the customers, of the C-suite. The red words, which are a little bit McKinsey words, light at the end of the tunnel, weakness, do not resonate quite well. We are traditionally isolated from the marketing function. What I want to say is that marketing via brand and communications via reputation are the yin and the yang of the organization. We work closely together. We should work closely together to have the biggest impact on the inside world and also on the outside world. Where we have to move away from measuring outputs to measuring outcomes. For me, it's much more important, in line with the previous speaker, to focus on the actual outcome, the impact on the business of all our public relationships, of how to manage the brand, how to facilitate a dialogue in a proper way. And there comes the magic word ROI. I do believe that we can establish an ROI for organizations. Not on financial terms, though. But I do think that we, as communications professionals, can come up with a metric to measure the outcomes of our activities in a reasonable, non-financial way. Because indeed, I have not gone that far that I relate my activities to actual sales growth or profitability growth. Indeed, I agree with the previous speaker, there are much more elements in an organization that contribute to that. But I think what we did in our Philips, we have found a metric that was widely used in the organization, that came from the marketing function, that was in 2009 or 2010 adapted by our board of management as one of the key KPIs for their own performance, and we translated that to the communication function, and that made my life much easier. I saw the previous speaker using the same slide, which at least demonstrates that we're thinking along the same lines, and that the Barcelona summit, the Barcelona principles, were one of the key drivers to accelerate the thinking about outcomes. Jim, I didn't see you in Madrid 2 weeks ago, but I think Madrid was another proof point of the fact that the industry wants to move towards a general thinking on outcomes. And when I heard the CEO of Ketchum, one of the agencies there, Rob Flaherty, he said he basically made a plea to the organization. He made a promise to the organization, to the people, to the audience. He said, we as big agencies, we will team up. We will team up together with the industry, with the companies, to come up with the same kind of metric that is used in the advertising industry. Because we should not compete with each other. We make our own life more difficult than it is. And I think he's right at the right time to do that, because if we don't do it, other companies like IBM might come up with the metrics that will be imposed on our function. And I think it's not needed, because we have a lot of knowledge already in our own industry. For me, the most important thing in 2010, when Barcelona principles were introduced, that we as communications function got rid of AVEs. Advertising value equivalent. And until 2010, AVEs were still used in my company. 3 years later, there's no AVE metric used in the communications function. What did we do? I already said we translated a marketing, a company KPI to the overall communications function. Everybody familiar with NPS? I don't hear a massive yes. I don't hear a massive yes. NPS stands for Net Promoter Score. And Net Promoter Score measures basically one question. Would you recommend this organization, this company, this product to someone else? On this question, you can score between a 0 and a 10. Between a 0 and a 4, you're rated as a detractor. Between a 4 and an 8, you are rated as a neutral, doesn't do anything for your company, doesn't do anything for your organization. Only between 8 and 10, if you would score between an 8 and a 10 on this question, would you recommend this organization, this product, this technology to someone else? That does matter, because then you're seen as a promoter for that organization, that company, or that product. So what we did, we started in 2010, first with external communication. We said, okay, we do a lot of output-related activities. We monitor, we do the clippings, we share the clippings, but what is actually happening there in the media? Do we actually know what kind of engagement is going on? And we used the NPS terminology, and we translated the NPS terminology and the NPS methodology overall across the globe to all our media activities across the globe. And we focused on quality instead of quantity. We went from measurement of 10,000 of titles around the world to only 650 titles around the world, because only those 650 titles around the world do matter, both traditional as well as non-traditional, social. If you're in a country like Germany, you don't have to monitor or measure 8,000 titles in Germany. No, there's only a couple of them that actually build or can destroy your reputation in an effective way. So what are we doing nowadays? In 2009, 2010, we built a measurement Ferrari for the organization with all the bells and whistles. It could drive 300 kilometers an hour, but we didn't have the drivers to drive those Ferrari. So we scaled back, because at that time we had a 24 hours a day measurement system available for our 150 communicators around the world. We scaled back and we made it more easy to access, easy to handle, easy to use, and easy to use, and that's the most important part, in discussions with your business partners. Because measuring, you do not only for your own function. If we start to measure and we continue to measure only for us as communication function, we do the wrong thing. What I did, and that was one of the reasons why we initiated this, I wanted to provide my communications function with a tool to have a proper, outcome-focused discussion with the business partners. And in the meantime, we have established that. Which is still not easy, because still a lot of communications people are not ready to have that proper discussion with the business partners, focused on outcomes, and also how to adjust a current communications plan in the right direction. Because I think that is one of the most important points of these kind of things, that you are able not only to reflect on all the great things you've done, but that you are able during the process on all the things you need to do to make it even better. 3 years later, it works well, but we're still in the process of further developing, further integrating, further providing guidance on how to facilitate discussions on the outcomes, on engagement, on dialogue, on adjustment within the organization. In 19 minutes, a short journey, some general trends, and some general trends related to how did we implement an outcome-focused methodology in Philips. I think the questions we have to leave for the discussion.